Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Could you just stand with us? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much once again for being here. We thank you for your grace and for your mercy. We thank you for your kindness and just for being wonderful of who you are. God, we ask that as we hear singing your songs and getting into your presence, we ask that you would help us to be mindful of those who did not make it today and their families, and that they would experience your love and your joy and your peace. Yes, do be with us in Jesus' name, we pray. Thank you. God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power. Our God. Our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power. Thank you.
Mariel does such a good job. So if you do know a family with young children. We do that at least once a month, and hopefully down the line we can do it more often. So March 26th is the next time. All right, so let's continue our series on the questions that Jesus asked. We've been looking at some of the questions that Jesus asked, and we started out this series talking about how many times Jesus asked questions, and the reason that he asked questions was to get at what people really were thinking, and also to make a point. And that is, you know, a lot of times that's you know, I will do stuff like that. If you ask me a question, don't be surprised if I answer your question with a question, because that's just kind of the way I do things. Because a question gets you to start thinking, right? When I ask your question, you have to actually think about the subject. And that is what Jesus did throughout his ministry. He asked questions to get people to think. And the question that we are looking at today, Jesus asked, how can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Now, a little context. You'll find this in Matthew chapter 12. Now, what happened is they bring to Jesus somebody who is demon-possessed. And Jesus drives out the demon and frees this person from the bondage of their possession. And people are amazed, obviously, right? I mean, everybody's been following Jesus. They're watching him work these miracles. They see him do something that they have never seen before. And, you know, of course, there's always that group of people, no matter what you do, there's always that group of people that are going to find fault with what you do. And in this case, in Jesus' case, it was the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribes. These were the religious leaders at the time, because they felt like Jesus was kind of leading people astray. And he just does this wonderful thing, right? Here is this person who is bound up. They are just miserable, living in a terrible existence. And Jesus sets them free. And the only thing they can think to themselves is, Jesus is taking away the attention from us. He's taking away the attention from the religious teachings. So when people go to the Pharisees and they tell them, hey, Jesus did this, can you believe it? And they say, well, Jesus casts out demons by the devil, the prince of demons. And so Jesus, when Jesus hears this, he tells a quick story. He says, any kingdom that is divided against itself will not stand. Now stop and think about that. That makes sense, doesn't it? If America is divided against itself, and it is, how can we stand? And this is why we see so many problems in our country, because we are a divided nation. We are divided against ourselves. We're divided along political lines. We're divided among moral lines. We're divided among religious lines. We just find new ways to divide ourselves. How can we stand? And then he asked the question, how can you go into a strong man's house and take his possessions unless you first bind the strong man? So what is he saying? He's saying, first of all, he's telling us that our battle is spiritual here. He is telling you that he has not come to fight a battle against the Pharisees, against the Sadducees, against the scribes. He has come to free people from the power of the enemy. He's telling us that there is a spiritual battle going on. And the only way you are going to win this spiritual battle is by binding up the spiritual forces that are at work. And we see that in Ephesians 6, verses 10 to 12. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Our battle is not against flesh and blood. I don't know how many ways the Bible can tell us that, right? I say this practically every week. That people are not our enemies. I wish we could get this in the church. I wish we could figure this out in the church. We would be so much more effective if we would just figure out that those people that you are talking to are not your enemy. It doesn't matter what they're doing. Maybe they're accusing you unjustly. Maybe they're yelling at you. Maybe they're treating you badly. They are not your enemy. There is a spiritual battle going on. There is a spiritual battle going on within them as well as around the world. Now just think about this. When you came to Jesus Christ, when you decided finally to come to the Lord to ask for forgiveness of your sins, there was a spiritual battle going on in you. What were you before that moment? What were you like before that moment? And now, what are you like now that you've come to Jesus Christ? That's the battle. See, Jesus has been waging a war for your soul from the very beginning. And he's fought for you. And it's the same thing now that you have come to know Jesus Christ. Do you not recognize the same battle in other people? Do you not recognize the look in their eyes? See, I recognize the look in a lot of people's eyes. You know why? Because I saw that same look in the mirror for a long time. That look of desperation. That look of just anger or loneliness or hopelessness. I know that look very well because I saw that look in the mirror. Do you not recognize, Christian? Do you not recognize the battle that is being fought for that person's soul? It is the same battle that was fought for your soul. And Jesus Christ won that battle, and he's still fighting the battle. Are you going to fight on his side, is the question. But too often we focus on people, and we think that people are our enemies. We think that politicians are our enemies because they belong to the wrong political party. We believe that people who identify as homosexual are our enemies, or who identify as transsexual are our enemies. Look, they are not the enemy. The person is not the enemy. We have an enemy, and that enemy is deceiving them. He is causing them to live outside of God's will, just like he did with you before you came to know Jesus Christ. And we get a little, you know, and this is my problem with Christians in general. We get a little proud of ourselves when we come to know Jesus Christ, as though we were the ones that somehow changed ourselves. There is nothing that you can do to change yourself. The Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit acts within you to will and to act according to his good pleasure. Do you know what that means? That even the desire to do good has to come from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit works inside of you to will, to desire to do good. Just the very desire to do good has to come from the Holy Spirit. It doesn't even come from you. Jesus said that no one can come to me except the Father who sent me draw them. You didn't come to Jesus on your own. The Father drew you to Jesus Christ. He wooed you into his kingdom. Right? I know you ladies love those romantic terms, right? He wooed you. They don't do anything for me. But the Lord wooed you into his kingdom. He pursued you. Just like a husband or a boyfriend pursues his girlfriend and tries to make her his wife. That is how God has pursued you. And he's doing the same for that person that you think is your enemy. That human being is not your enemy. Now, they may be living in sin. They may be living contrary to God's word. But so did you at one time. And you have come to know Jesus Christ, not because of your own effort, not because you're so smart, not because you're so wise, but because the Father drew you to God. The Bible tells us that when the Holy Spirit comes, right, he will convict the world of sin. The Holy Spirit will convict the world of sin. Jesus didn't say, when the Holy Spirit comes, you will convict the world of sin. No, he said the Holy Spirit will convict the world of sin. And we know from the scriptures that it was Jesus who forgives sins. So there it is. The Father draws them. The Holy Spirit convicts them. And Jesus forgives them. So where are we in that equation? We're nowhere to be found, folks. You do not save souls. It is God Almighty who saves a soul. So what do we do? What is our job? Our job is to remove obstacles from their path. Whatever it is, whatever objection they have to coming to Jesus Christ, we've got to be able to remove those obstacles. Now look, there are some things that we will never be able to compromise. We have to live by God's word, because it is God's word. We have to live by the word of God. We cannot compromise the word of God. We can never compromise the word of God. But see, we can look to Jesus as an example for this, because Jesus never compromised the scriptures. He never once compromised the scriptures, and yet he could still be considered a friend of sinners. Why? Because he understood that the people are not the enemy. Jesus understood that woman at the well that had been married 5 times and was with someone that wasn't her husband, he understood she wasn't the enemy. And that's the whole thing. Sometimes we can find ourselves fighting the wrong battles. And we see this throughout Scripture. And that's especially true of the Pharisees. John 11, 45 through 48 says, "Therefore many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus had done..." I'm sorry, I just skipped over something. "Therefore many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin and said, 'What are we accomplishing? Here is this man performing many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and then the Romans will come and take away both our temple and our nation.'" First of all, this is where Jesus had just raised Lazarus from the dead. Okay, now it's one thing to free somebody from the power of demon possession. He raised Lazarus from the dead. He had been dead for 3 days. Or was it 4 days? I don't remember. I'm sorry. Whatever it was, he had been dead for several days. Jesus raised him from the dead. And what are they worried about? They're worried about their religious practices. It's like, if we let him go on like this, then the Romans are going to come and they're going to take away our temple. What? Jesus just raised somebody from the dead, people. And this is what they're worried about. They're worried about their temple and their nation. They're worried about their ethnic identity. Jesus has just performed a miraculous sign. He's telling them, "I'm here, guys. I'm the Messiah you've been waiting for. I'm the one that is coming to set you free from the power of the enemy." And the only thing they can think of is, "Oh, we're going to lose our temple. We're going to lose our place in this world." They're fighting the wrong battle because they don't understand who the real enemy is. Jesus had come to bind up the real enemy, because he asked the question, how can you plunder a strong man's house unless you first bind the strong man? He came to bind up the power of Satan and to take the prisoners and set them free. That was a prophecy of the Messiah in Isaiah. He has come to preach liberty to the prisoners. He came to preach freedom, but they wanted the bondage of the law that they couldn't even keep. They wanted that. They wanted the law. They wanted their traditions. They wanted their cultural identity instead of Jesus Christ. Now, look, I have no problem with cultural identity. Don't get me wrong. I'm Hispanic. I love being Hispanic. I love Spanish music. I love speaking in Spanish. Although I don't speak it as well as my mother would like. I love being Spanish. You ask me, if what I am, I'm going to tell you I'm Puerto Rican. I'm not going to tell you I'm an American. Now, I am an American. You hear that, Ice? I am an American. Just in case any of you listen. I am an American. But when you ask me for my cultural identity, I'm going to tell you I am Puerto Rican. But you know what? My cultural identity is not more important to me than my spiritual identity. First and foremost, I am a preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am a minister for the Lord. That goes above being Hispanic. That goes above being Spanish. And whatever traditions are involved in being a Hispanic, they get cast away if they are in violation of God's word, or if they keep me from the freedom that God provides. Because I know the battle that I'm fighting. In Mark chapter 5, the Bible tells us of a demon-possessed man. Jesus goes and he crosses the lake and he goes to a region and there is a demon-possessed man there. And the Bible says that he was often bound with chains, but he would break the chains and he would go off and live among the tombs. And Jesus came and set him free. You see, the people of that region, they were fighting the wrong battle. They looked at this demon-possessed man and they didn't see a hopeless soul. They didn't see someone who was hopelessly lost. They saw their enemy. They saw someone who was disruptive. They saw someone that they needed to bind up and chain even further. Jesus came and he fought the right battle. He went right to the problem. He looked at the man and he said, "What is your name?" And the demons that were inside this man, they spoke. And he drove them out. And he freed this man. And when the townspeople came to see what had happened, they found this man fully dressed and in his right mind. Because Jesus chose the right battle. I just talked a couple minutes ago about the woman at the well. I love this story. Do you know why I love this story so much? Because the Jews hated the Samaritans. Okay? I mean, this was, if you can hate any human being on this planet, the Jews hated the Samaritans. As a matter of fact, if they had to walk from one area of Israel to another, rather than going through Samaria, they would take the extra time and go around Samaria. That's how much they hated these people. But you know what the Bible tells me? The Bible says that Jesus had to go through Samaria. Love that. I love that. You see, have you ever felt shunned by people? Have you ever felt alone? Have you ever felt like people didn't want you around? You know what Jesus says? I have to go there. I have to go to that person. Jesus had to go to Samaria. Not only did he have to go to Samaria, he had to meet the one person in that entire town who had a bad reputation. See, this woman had two things going against her, right? First of all, she was a Samaritan. And Jews didn't associate with Samaritans. Second of all, she was labeled as promiscuous. So she couldn't go out early in the morning, in the cool of the day. She couldn't go to the well along with all the noble women of the town. See, all the women of the town would get together at the well. This was a time for the women to get together to gossip and talk and, you know, exchange stories and complain about their husbands, whatever. You know, kind of the same thing you guys do now. That women would get together, but they would do it in the early morning because it would be a little cooler and they'd be carrying those big, heavy water jugs. So they would go early in the morning. Now, if you had a bad reputation, if you weren't welcome in polite society, then you had to go later in the day. And Jesus came and it was about noon, the heat, the hottest part of the day, and this woman had to go to the well at that time. And Jesus spoke to her. You see, the townspeople were fighting the wrong battle. See, this woman was looking for somebody to love her. She was looking for a deep connection with someone. And she kept failing in relationship after relationship after relationship. And you know what the townspeople, they saw? What they saw? They saw a loose woman. They saw somebody that they should shun and not be around. Jesus came and he fought the right. He said, "You know what? If you're thirsty, come to me, and I'll give you something to drink, and you'll never be thirsty again." He said, "Come to me and experience the love that you've never experienced before." And that woman became an evangelist for her town. She went out, and she told everybody what Jesus had said to her. She became the evangelist to spread the word about Jesus Christ. See, because Jesus fought the right battle. And finally, in John chapter 18, we read when they come to arrest Jesus Christ. Peter, I love Peter. He's so much like me. Always act first and ask questions later, you know. Kind of that shoot first mentality. You know, that's Peter. So they come to arrest Jesus Christ. And Peter pulls out his sword and he cuts off the high priest's servant's ear. And Jesus said, "Put your sword away. How are scriptures going to be fulfilled? And you know why? Do you know why Peter did this? You got to go a few verses earlier. Jesus goes to the garden and he goes off to pray. And he tells the disciples, stay here and pray with me. And he goes off to pray and he comes back. He finds them sleeping. He found them asleep. And he woke them up. He said, listen, you got to pray with me. He said, stay here, watch, and pray with me. And he went off and he prayed again. Came back, found them asleep again. Jesus finally left them alone. He went off and prayed again. For 3 hours, he was praying. And that's why when they came for him, he was at peace. But that's also why when they came for him, Peter was ready to fight the wrong battle. Because he hadn't gone. He hadn't listened to Jesus. He hadn't gone and prayed with Jesus Christ. If he had prayed with Jesus, he would have known that this is what was supposed to happen. And this is why we end up fighting the wrong battles. We need to spend more time with God, folks. I don't think I could say it any other way. It does not get any simpler than that. We are influenced by the people we spend the most time with. And we know that. I mean, instinctively, we know that, right? The people we spend the most time with, we kind of develop the same habits. We kind of talk the same things like that. So if you spend the most time with God, then you're going to be more like God. You're going to be more like Jesus. And this is why we end up fighting the wrong battles, because we don't spend the time with God, because we're too busy. We're too busy on our phones. We're too busy with our careers. We're too busy with whatever to spend time with God. And you know what? We can criticize Peter in this instance, but every single one of us is the same thing. We're running around cutting people's ears off left and right, and Jesus is trying to tell us, stop it. You're fighting the wrong battle. There are times to defend yourself, and there are times when you've just got to trust God. How do we know the difference? You got to spend time with God to know the difference. And this is the principle. Jesus spent 3 hours in prayer that night. Why? Because he was about to be crucified. The more intense the coming trial, the more time you have got to spend with God. The more time you spend around people who are immoral, the more time you are going to have to spend with God so that you can live among those people. Because let's face it, we can't just shelter in this church. This is not a monastery. We cannot just shelter in here and never go out in the world. That's not our mission anyway. Even if we could do that, we shouldn't, because Jesus Christ told us, go. He said, go into the world and preach the gospel. He said, go into the world and make disciples. So we can't just shelter here. We've got to get out there into this dark world and shine the light of Jesus Christ. Well, how are you going to do that? How are we supposed to do that? How are we supposed to know what battles we're supposed to fight? You've got to spend time with God. Please don't tell me that I should be fighting the battle that you're fighting. And when I ask you, how much time have you spent in prayer about this? If you tell me none, I'm hanging up the phone on you, okay? Because I get this all the time. People want to know why I'm not more politically active, why I don't rail against the immorality of this political party or that political party. You want to know why? Because I spend time with God and I know what battles I'm supposed to be fighting. Now listen, I have no problem with political activism. Maybe you get the idea. Maybe you have gotten the false impression, and it's my own fault, because I do emphasize this week after week. Maybe you've gotten the impression that you should not be politically active. Look, we live in a free society. That is a blessing. It is a blessing to live in a free society where you can get politically active. But do not confuse political activism with spiritual activism. You are not doing God's work simply because you vote for a specific candidate. That's the distinction I want you to understand. You are fighting the wrong battle if you think you are making a spiritual impact by fighting in the political arena. That's the distinction I want you to understand. We have got to fight the right battles. You know why? Because in politics, that division I get every time I hear about these political struggles going on, I see Peter chopping people's ears off. That's what I see. Because that's what we're doing. We're going around chopping people's ears off, left and right, in the political arena. Because we're not spending the time with God to understand what battle we should be fighting. The Republicans are not your enemy, Democrat. And the Democrats are not your enemies, Republicans. First Peter 2, 1 through 3. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. James 4, 8. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Jeremiah 29, 11 through 13. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come to me and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. That is such a wonderful promise. It is such a wonderful promise that if you just would seek after God, he will be found by you. What is more important than that? Is that cat video online that much more important than that? Will you not sacrifice that cat video for the sake of spending a little more time with Jesus Christ? Is that Instagram influencer so much more wise that you are dispensing with your time with God? Jesus, the Lord said, if you seek me, you will find me. You will find him. We don't preach a gospel where God is unknowable, guys. There are plenty of religions that preach an unknowable God. Our God is not just knowable. Our God came and experienced life the way that we live it. Our God came and experienced all the hurt and all the pain that we experience. Our God lived at a time when he experienced hunger, he experienced thirst, he experienced fatigue, he experienced betrayal, he experienced loneliness. Everything that you could possibly imagine that you've gone through, Jesus has gone through. He came as a human being, took on this corruptible flesh so that he could relate to you. That's the God that we preach for. He's a God that is near to us. He's a God that understands us. If you draw near to God, he will draw near to you. And if you draw near to God and he draws near to you, you will understand what battles you're supposed to be fighting. I mean, have you ever felt like a hamster on a wheel, guys? Yeah. I know I have. Just standing there. I feel sorry for hamsters, quite frankly. I mean, they're getting exercise. This is why I stopped using my treadmill, because that's what I felt like. You know, you're just running and running and running and running and running, and you're not getting anywhere. The scenery doesn't change at all. That's what happens when we don't spend time with God, and we try to do things in our own wisdom. We try to do things in our own strength. We're just running on the wheel. We're just running on that treadmill. And we're expending a whole lot of energy, but we're not getting anywhere. You need to get off that treadmill. Get with God. God will tell you, hey, this is where you need to go. This is the person you need to talk to. This is the battle you need to be fighting. You want to see your family saved? Go to God. Remember what I told you? We don't save anybody. You need to go to the one who will actually save them. And finally, we need to recognize that God really is in control. When Peter cut off the servant's ear, Jesus rebuked him. In Matthew 26, 53, he said, do you think that I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? You know what he was telling Peter? It's like, Peter, I got this. And this is the problem. We go around cutting people's ears because we don't really trust God. We don't really trust that God is in control. We look around us and say, look, the whole world's going to hell in a handbasket. I've got to do something. I've got to go around cutting people's ears off. And Jesus is like, chill out, dude. I got this. God really is in control. He has this under control. There is no political force. There is no war. There is no pandemic that will take God's control away. We've got to rest in that fact. Isaiah 41:10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Romans 8:26 through 28. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things, God works for the good for those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. Proverbs 16:9. In their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps. Psalms 46:10. Come and see what the Lord has done. Actually, that's more than verse 10, but I think it's 8 through 10, but don't quote me on that. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Let me tell you something. It doesn't matter how bad things get. God will be exalted. It doesn't matter how many wars break out. God will be exalted. You can take that promise to the bank. You can be still and know that he is still God. He is still the omnipresent, omnipotent, all-powerful God. He is the God who saved my soul. Back when I was a hopeless sinner, back when I was angry with the world, back when I was just lashing out left and right at the people around me, God saw me and he took pity on me. That's the God I preach. The God that transformed me into a minister of the gospel. You guys don't even understand what a miracle that is, that I am standing here preaching God's word. You have no idea, because you didn't know me back then. My wife knows what a miracle this is. My mother knows what a miracle this is. You guys have no idea the transformation that God has wrought. You have no idea the transformation that God has made possible in my life. You just don't know what God can do because you're not spending the time with him. You are fighting the wrong battles. We need to go back to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We need to go back to the one who rules over all the earth, because he will fight the battle. Bow your heads, church. In Luke chapter 10, we read the story of Mary and Martha. Jesus came to their house. Martha was busy with all the preparations, running around like a crazy person. Mary sat at Jesus' feet. But Martha came and she complained to Jesus, said, make Mary help me. You know what Jesus said? He said, Mary has chosen the right thing, and it won't be taken from her. Let me ask you something, Christian. Are you a Mary or are you a Martha? Are you running around like a chicken with your head cut off? Are you running around chopping people's ears off? Or are you sitting at the feet of Jesus Christ? Because Jesus said, that's the right answer. Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus. I pray, Lord, that you will help us to get this in our hearts. Lord, as your word says, you work within us to will and to act, dear God. Give us the will. Give us the will, Lord. Give us the wisdom to know that time spent with you is the most important thing that we can do any day of our lives. Help us to know the right battles to fight, dear God. Because we're losing. It really is just that simple. We are losing because we continue to fight the wrong battles. Help us, Father. Help us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. That is my prayer. Bless these people as they go in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, church.